Thanks for staying with us. Now, I found this picture, and after reading it, it formed the basis for tonight's conversation. So as I read this piece written by an unknown source, please carefully follow. At the entrance gate of a university in South Africa, the following message was posted for contemplation. Destroying any nation does not require the use of atomic bombs or the use of long-range missiles. It only requires lowering the quality of education and allowing cheating in examinations by the students. Parents die, or rather patients die at the hands of such doctors. Buildings collapse at the hands of such engineers. Money is lost at the hands of such economists and accountants. Humanity dies at the hands of such religious scholars. Justice is lost at the hands of such judges. The collapse of education is the collapse of the nation. Now, Nigeria over the years has seen our educational institutions at all levels suffer great degradation. If education plays such a huge role in a nation, how can we rebuild our educational institution for the good of our nation? Please let us hear what you have to say. Remember, you can join this conversation, tweet at us at WeShowAfrica1 with the hashtag WeShow, or you send us an SMS or WhatsApp to 081-803-84663. So when I read this picture, I mean, I just looked at it, I said, wow. It got me thinking, right? Because maybe sometimes we do not paint the vivid picture. I now remember Nigeria, how we now buy results. I mean, we've been doing it for years. I mean, Jennifer took a story yesterday on JAMB, you know, arresting two people that they found guilty, that he collected 500,000 from four students to be able to pass the JAMB exams and all of that. These are things that are common, special centers, parents doing all of that. The level of our educational system is so bad now that we do not even know, you know, we do not know the ripple effect. So where you lack in this, or where you look away and you allow impunity, see the ripple effect. So when they broke it down, you know, to how doctors, building collapse, and all of those things, I say, wow. You know, so let me hear your thoughts.
First, I'll say the thoughts on what you just read is quite profound, first things first. And I totally agree with that write-up, because look at it from every angle. We've totally lost it. Is it in terms of the leader, the quality of leaders we have? Is it in the quality of education we have? And this thing is not just in Nigeria, it's in developing countries. So another thing is, do we have a higher hand playing a demigod with the Africans or underdeveloping countries, or developing countries, sorry? That's another question for another day. But the key thing here is that our education system is the way it is because there has been so much decay in the system. It didn't even start today. It started years ago.
Okay, let me come to Maury. Maury, quickly, what are your thoughts on the conversation that we're having today? You know.
Okay, so when we were reading the picture, the first sentence actually resonated with me. You know, the one that says that we don't need missiles to destroy, or atomic bombs to destroy a nation. You know, take from even just here, just from voting. Like, imagine that the people who cover the majority of the votes, as the Northerners, imagine that they were actually educated and informed enough to know that your vote is actually powerful. I don't think that we will be in the state that we are currently as a country. So I totally, like, it's such a deep picture. It's such a deep word in a picture. And I totally agree with it. And I'm very, very glad to be a part of this conversation today.
Thank you so much. So thank you to Mr. Saleh that sent me the picture. All right, so Taiwo Akilami is a social development lawyer, a co-founder of Power Parenting Company, Parents' Rights to Social Protection advocate and publisher. Akilami is arguably Africa's foremost child protection thinker and practitioner. Being the founder and the principal of Taiwo Akilami Child Protection Academy, his unique philosophy and teachings on family strengthening, child protection, and related matters have been well received in over 133 countries. Akilami is also a prolific writer, poet, and blogger. He's joined us again live from Dallas. Thank you so much, Taiwo Akilami, for joining us again.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so blessed. Second missionary journey
in this week, yes. So, but I'm so happy that I'm having you to have this conversation. Taiwo, when you saw that picture that I read, you know, what came to your mind?
Well, the picture is very profound. Statements there, the truth contained in the statements are eternal. They cannot be argued with. They cannot be in any way disputed. That is how it is. When people are not properly educated, what happens is that they are not able to own their authenticity, that they do not understand who they are, and at the end of the day, it affects the value and the contributions they make and what they bring to table. Mm-hmm. When it comes to Nigeria, I think that we need to understand that there are two groups. There are two groups that we are dealing with. Number one, you have those who have gone to school, but they have not gone to school. One of the greatest crises that we are dealing with today is unemployability. People have gone to school, but they have not learned the basics. In my work with the British Council, since 2013, I've worked with the British Council to train on school leadership and what we call core and transferable skills. Then there we found that many of the people who are in school in Nigeria are not fit, no, in sub-Saharan Africa, are not fit for the workplace. They are not able to make tangible contribution. It was found that for us to catch up, we are going to need two generations. That two generation, if you use the English dictionary, a generation is 30 years. So we are 60 years behind schedule in being able to catch up. Now, if you use the Bible, the book that I read, the Bible reckons generation as 40 years. So we need 80 years. So if I choose the lesser evil, which is the English dictionary, it means that we are 60 years behind schedule in learning the basics. Now, I'm talking about those who are in school, learning the basics, because the purpose of education is to prepare you for contribution, is to prepare you for exchange, is for you to be able to bring value to table. When you're not able to exchange value, despite the level of education you claim to have, what we are dealing with is that you have gone to school, you have not gone to school. Unfortunately, that is the situation we are dealing with now. Since early 2000, I was working with an organization known as ADGC, After School Graduate School or something. Why was that organization founded? It was founded by Dayton Ogwo and Mrs. Ibukun Awosika. Why did they come up with that organization? Because they realized that many of our young people who have been churned out of the university are not able, they are not employable. The problem is not employment, unemployment. That is a problem. The other problem is unemployability. They are not even fit to take their place in the marketplace. So that organization was established to now begin to retrain graduates. I worked with them for some years in doing that. We trained hundreds or thousands of graduates, you know. That's one level. The other level is those who don't even have access to education. They have not been in the four walls of the university, of primary education, secondary education, not to talk about tertiary education. Now, those group are 13.5 million. UNICEF say, out of every five people out of school in the world, Nigeria is
one out of three.
Every five. One is out of, 13.5 million Nigerian children are out of school, and it is increasing. Now, apart from the fact that they are out of school, now, during COVID, 46 million Nigerian children did not have access to education because they could not access, they did not have access to
facility.
The internet when there was lockdown. Not only that, 36 million people who were trying to get adult education were also locked out, which means in a country of 180 million people, 80 million people were locked out as a result of COVID. So we are dealing with a major crisis. But you see, this crisis in itself is not independent. There's a root cause to that crisis. I think that crisis is deliberately inflicted on the people. Now, look, there's a man called Adebayo Williams. In 1993, he wrote an article titled "Remembering Rufus." He was talking about the crisis that happened, that the protest that accompanied the annulment of June 12th. And he wrote that article, Remembering Rufus, in the newspaper known as Tempo. He made a statement which I can never forget. That's 1993. He said, a properly educated mind will not accept an act of tyranny. Because to accept an act of tyranny is an act of intellectual self-dispossession. In this statement lies the reason why those who are in the political class do not want Nigerians to be educated.
Properly educated.
They don't want Nigerians to be educated. That is the position. That is their position. Because this is the question. If it is that the ruling class do not know the worth of education, we will see that they don't send their own children to school. They send their children to school. They get the best of education in the best of universities in the world. And now, how come it is the children of the poor, the oipoloi, the house of wood and drafts of water, are the ones that do not have access to education? That is a conversation we need to have. How come they are the one being denied? So that is the issue. I think that right from when we're negotiating independence, so-called independence, we were not upfront as to what we wanted to do as a nation or how we want to handle our affairs as a nation. And that has affected the way we have operated and the way we have dealt with children, the way we have dealt with education, the way we have dealt with health, the way we have dealt with social protection and all of that.
Thank you so much, Taiwo.
Wow.
That's a lot to take it. Go ahead, Issy.
Now, this is, you've actually opened my eyes to a few things, and the mindset of every learner in the education system is very paramount, it's important. And in this context, I'm looking at the emotional intelligence, because emotional intelligence plays a huge role. In education, there is something we do, we train the children cognitive skills, psychomotor skills, and affective skills. The affective skills has to do with the heart. So my question to you is this. The kind of leaders we've churned out in Nigeria currently today, Aristotle said that when you fail to educate the mind, it is no education at all. So do you think that the kind of leaders we have today, we have failed to educate them psychologically and as well as affectively in terms of their emotions? So what role does emotional intelligence play in this?
So let's begin with somebody who is able to know the difference between right and wrong. Let's begin from being able to understand being human.
Precisely.
To be a human being. Let's begin from there. The challenge we are dealing with is the fact that, you see, the problem of Nigeria is hydrated. You know, when we were negotiating independence, what happened in independence was that we didn't get independence. I'm going somewhere so that I need to explain this so that I can make sense to your out of your question and be able to answer it properly. So in independence, the white men were the one in charge. They were the one, you know, ruling us. Those who went to school in Nigeria saw that after the Second World War, they saw that there was not too much difference between us and the white man in terms of, you know, weaknesses, in terms of strength. So what did they do? They began to agitate for what they call independence. So what did they do? They wanted to take over what the white man was enjoying, so they too, they can be enjoying it. So the white man saw where they were going, so they had an agreement. You remain in charge, we remain in power. We give you power. But whatever is going to happen is going to be undone from our end here. So what happened in 1960 is a form of indirect rule. So you now have what white man used to occupy, black man is now occupying it. So there's no commitment as to educating our people. Before you talk about emotional intelligence, you must talk about understanding who you are as a person, understanding your corporate identity, your community identity, your communal commitment. When you do not understand all of that, when we begin to talk to you about emotional intelligence, it's like we are fetching water inside a basket. It's not going to work. So the foundational thing, first of all, as a person is, am I a person? Am I human? What are my obligations towards me, towards my neighbor? What are my obligations towards my community? And all of that. Once you get that right as human, am I a citizen? What is citizenship? Am I patriotic? What does it mean to be patriotic? Once we do not get all of these fundamental principles right, it's going to be difficult for us to even to be intelligent enough to understand who we are, not to talk of understanding yourself enough, to be able to understand the issues of other people and put yourself in the shoes of those people so that you can act from where they are and give them justice and be nice and be kind and be proactive and be productive. That is the whole essence of emotional intelligence. But what we are dealing with here is that we are dealing with people who have not even understood that they are human. You know, because you see, how can somebody stack away an amount of money that he or she cannot spend in a lifetime. We are still talking about somebody being human. Human. We have not understood what it means to be human. What are the characteristics of human beings? We are yet to understand that. So, you know, so A levels, advanced level is emotional intelligence. The first thing is that, do you understand what it means to be human?
Let me come to Maury. Maury, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. So my question is a bit dicey. Yeah, there's been arguments as to whether or not you need to go to school to be educated, you know, like as to whether education can only be, you know, gotten from like a systematic environment with four walls. Like Elon Musk, now he will, like in his articles or when he's granting interviews, he will say that I didn't go to Harvard, but the people who did work for me, you know, there have been cases where people who have done great things have been like dropouts or, you know, didn't go to school. So do you necessarily have to go to school to be educated?
Okay.
Well, education, you know, when you are talking about people like Elon Musk, you can also add Bill Gates. You can also add
Facebook, Mark Zuckerberg, yes.
You can add all of these people. You can say they didn't go to school. In what system?
Mm-hmm.
In what system? You know, in Nigeria, you need to understand where we are, the peculiar place we are as a third world country. As a third world country, they call us developing country. As a matter of fact, I call us underdeveloped or stagnated. That's where we are. So when you look at where we are, and you look at, see, there are support systems in the developed climb to support your dreams and aspirations in terms of in terms of education or qualification. There are many qualifications, there are many certifications that are available, and they are not going to look at you less than somebody who has a college education and all of that. Those are fundamental issues. Now, in Nigeria, Nigeria is a certificated society. Those who did not go to school in Nigeria, they are not even bold to come out to say they didn't go to school. And those who did not go to school and they have been able to do one or two things for themselves are not even bold enough to come out to say they didn't go to school. Because, you know, the day they come to say that they didn't go to school, those who used to support them may withdraw the support. Exactly. So you didn't go to school, you don't have a degree. Only few people have been able to come out to say that they didn't go to school. And when we are talking about education, I think it is important for us to understand that fundamentally, it is educed to bring out that which is inside of you. Now, those things are already deposited there by the Creator, by God. Now, you don't want to bring it out. But today, the world is looking beyond your math and English. You know, this is what Jack Ma has said. Jack Ma said that in the year 2030, 800 million jobs, that's 9 years from now, that was pre-COVID. 800 million jobs will have been taken by machine. Please note, the people who are going to lose their job is not that they are going to die. It's because that they are going to become irrelevant because their skill can no more meet up with what they needed to do.
Current technology.
So machines are going to take over. So the thinking that Harvard has not found that where we are in Nigeria, that's we are talking about math and English and all of those things. Being good in math, being a 2-1 student, all of that. Now, Harvard has now found that to succeed in life, having studied men that have made a difference, and women, and organizations, for you to succeed in life and make a difference, you need only 20% of technical skill, hard skill. You need 80% of soft skill. That is creativity. That is citizenship. Citizenship used to be a status. It is now a skill. You need to be skillful. It's a skill now in soft skill, collaboration, and all of that. You need all of those things. Now we are still dealing with what is now obsolete. That's what we still want to give children.
And
it is in the midst of this that children are being chased out of school. In the northern part of the country, they shut down all schools now. Those who manage to go to school in the north are not able to go to school now because there's insecurity. And all of that.
Mm-hmm.
So when you are dealing with all of that, I don't even know where we need to start from. But where do we go from here?
Okay, you know what, Taiwo, we will come back to where we go from here, but we need to just take a very short break. When we return, we'll continue the conversation. Okay. Stay with us. We'll be right back.